oceans cry out to you. The mountains, they bow down before you. So join with the earth, and I'll give my praise to you. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh, Lord,
series today called Faith HD, and so Jody will be sharing a little bit more about that, and we'll be singing to that first lesson this morning about creation and our belief in God. So I hope you'll be able to see those through the songs that we share together. If you're a guest, we would ask you to fill out a card. If you're a member, we would ask you to fill out a card and put that in the collection tray later so that we can have a record of everybody being here. Thanks again. Let's take a moment, stand and say hi to somebody, and we'll continue our worship. Thanks for being here.
Tremble in your holy presence.
The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands.
Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge.
They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them.
And yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens, God has pitched a tent for the sun.
It is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, like a champion rejoicing to come to run his course.
It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is deprived of its warmth.
Would you be seated, please? You're always sneaking up on me.
Hey, good morning. Some years ago, our church decided that instead of trying to support a bunch of different foreign mission works, we were going to focus on one. And I think that was a really wise decision, because that creates the opportunity for us to have a really close personal relationship, not just with the missionaries, the American missionaries that we're working with, but with the people in that location. And I'm really happy about the mission work that was chosen here. It's a place in Ecuador. It's called Hacienda of Hope, and it's a children's home, an orphanage, which just automatically sounds really sad, doesn't it? The word orphanage just sounds awful. I was able to go down there last week for my first visit, and it's not awful, and it's not sad. It is awesome, and it is joyful, because there are over 30 children that now have a place where they are safe, and they are loved, and they are fed, and they are taught, and they are cared for. Our last night there, we had a devotional in what they call the prayer dome. And it's this outdoor structure surrounded by these incredible mountains. And we sang in Spanish and in English. And then at the end of it, the missionaries asked the children if they wanted to say anything to Tim and Steve and me. And what they said was, thank you for giving us a safe place. Thank you for giving us a place where we're loved and cared for. It was really, really very touching. My favorite part of the visit, though, was on our first night, we had a devotional in one of the casas. I learned my favorite phrase when I was down there was, ¿cómo se dice? Which means, how do you say? They got a real kick out of it when I said, how do you say, how do you say? So, ¿cómo se dice? Was my favorite phrase, and casa is house, one of the houses. They had a devo for a dinner for us, and then they had a devo that night. And all the kids come together in this one casa. There are four of them, and there are 30 kids. And John Arieger, one of our missionaries, said, "Who wants to say our memory verse?" And they're learning this memory verse. And she said, "I want you to say all of it." And then one kid said, I'll do it. And he led the whole group. So over 30 kids all quoted Psalm 19, 1 through 6, the passage that we just heard read just a moment ago. And you've got all these children. I didn't understand a single word they said. They're quoting it in Spanish. But they quoted the whole thing, Psalm 19, 1 through 6, about how the mountains declare the glory of God. How the heavens declare the glory of God. How God is present in nature and in us. And it was such a beautiful moment. Once a year, we take up a collection for Hacienda, for this mission work. And our goal this year is to collect $246,000. Now, that does not include the salaries for our missionaries. We pay that out of our regular giving. Every week when you give, we're just taking care of our missionaries. This is to fund the mission work. Every penny that we give today and in the coming days is going straight to take care of these kids. We need $246,000. Everything above our budget today, our regular church budget, goes into that goal. And if you didn't come prepared to give today, you can do that later on this week. We're happy to take your checks later on. But everything you give today goes toward the kids. We're going to pass the plate one time, so if you wrote two checks today, put them, one for the regular contribution here at Twickenham and one for Hacienda, put them both in. And I just want to pray over it and ask God to bless us with generous hearts, ask God to bless our kids who were there, our missionaries who were there, and I just want you to know, having been there and seen it, this is a really solid work. God is doing some awesome things down there through our missionaries, through us, and especially through those sweet children. Let's pray over our contribution. God, thank you for blessing us enormously. We enjoy so many material blessings. While it's true that some of us in the room this morning struggle financially, even those of us in the United States who struggle to make ends meet are often so much more financially, materially blessed than people in other places. We are thankful that we have been able to provide resources so that children who have been abused and neglected can have a place of safety, a place of love, a place where they are taught who you are, a place where they can grow physically and emotionally and spiritually and mentally. God, we pray that we would be generous. We pray that a spirit of generosity would pervade our church today and in the coming weeks as we try to fund this ministry, this important mission, and that we would give generously, knowing that these funds are handled with utmost integrity, knowing that they are blessing children who otherwise might not be blessed. Thank you for all you've given us. Help us to be like you, givers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We believe in God the Father.
We believe in God the Father.
We believe in Christ the Son.
We believe in Christ the Son.
We believe in the Holy Spirit.
We believe in the Holy Spirit.
We are the church and we stand as one.
We are the church and we stand as one.
We believe in the Holy Bible.
We believe in the Holy Bible.
We believe in the Virgin Birth.
Worthy, worthy, worthy.
Good morning. I hope you've enjoyed the last several weeks, as I have, to hear a little bit about the ministry that's going on down in Ecuador, the Hacienda of Hope. And we've kind of focused on one word, which was transitioned as a part of that, which I think was important. It was pertinent. And to be able to see how some of those kids from many years ago have made a transition now into adulthood has been powerful to me. And I hope it has been to you. But there's another word that I think of, and as I thought this week about what goes on at the Hacienda of Hope, there's a word that continued to come to my mind. And that word is rescue. It's rescue. It just seems to me that we've had such an opportunity there to rescue children from situations that were dire, that were devastating, that were overwhelming, that were hopeless, and to be able to transition them into a situation of hope and of joy and of love and of the truth of Jesus Christ has been an incredible opportunity that continues even today. And so as we get ready to share communion today, I wonder if we could just think a little bit about that word, rescue. Because it occurred to me that we are in a position to be rescuers because we were first rescued. And that God did that for us through the person of his son, Jesus. And that's what we celebrate today as we get ready to take communion. The Apostle Paul said that in a letter that he wrote to the church in Colossae, in Colossians chapter 1. He said this, "For he, God, has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption and the forgiveness of sins." You know, one of the stated missions down at the Hacienda is to introduce the people of Ecuador to Jesus. That's a simple mission, but it is all-encompassing. And as the Apostle Paul would say, we have been rescued from the dominion of darkness, and we've been transitioned into the kingdom of the Son. And so as we focus this morning on having this communion time together, I think it's important to consider the significance of the Son, of Jesus. And Paul goes on to tell us a little bit more in this letter of Colossians about the Son. Listen to these words. "The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authority. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross." I hope you heard those key words. We've been rescued. That God, through the power of his Son, redeemed us and reconciled us to himself. That's a powerful message. And it's one that we'll celebrate this morning. What we're going to do now is we're going to eat a meal together, a form of a meal. It goes all the way back to the time of Jesus, before he went to the cross, when he shared a meal with his disciples, and he broke bread, and he passed a cup, and he said, "This bread is my body. This cup is my blood." And so we're going to eat a piece of cracker this morning as a reminder of the body of Jesus given for us. And we're going to drink this cup as a reminder of the blood that he shed. And through that shedding of the blood, God has brought us into the household of the redeemed and has reconciled us to himself through Jesus, his son. If you're visiting with us, we invite you to share in this meal with us. Let's pray together. Father, we just thank you for the fact that you have been our rescuer, and that through us, then, we can be an extension of your grace. And not by anything that we would do or bring to the table, but because of the power of Jesus. And so we recognize this morning the Son. And Father, we hold on to the truth that Jesus was there from the foundations of the world, that the plan was already in place even before you created us, and that all things were made through him, by him, and for him, and that, Father, even today he holds all things together. And so we say thank you for that truth. And as we eat this bread together, we remember the body of our Lord given for us. As we eat this together, Father, we just ask that you remind us of the truth and the reality of Jesus. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above
Father, as we take this cup, we remember the blood of Jesus shed on the cross for our sins. And Father, we just thank you for the saving power that you brought through the person of your Son. And as we drink this cup together, we remember that sacrifice. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all.
Kind of like that song, don't you? They kind of like that song. Hey, want to welcome some new members here, Grant and Cindy Reynolds and their son John David, who's in the eighth grade. Grant and Cindy, can you guys stand? Where are you guys? They're right there. Welcome them. Glad to have them. They have a daughter as well, Libby, who's at UT in Knoxville. So welcome to the Reynolds. Glad to have them with us. We'll be introducing some more next week, but glad to have the Reynolds. Grant's the coach, football coach at Madison Academy. So go Mustangs, right? So I wanted to, we're going to start a new series this morning called High Definition Faith or Faith HD. My sense is that we have this, we kind of know what we believe, kind of, on a lot of things, but there are things that we're not always really clear on. And so what we're going to do is once or twice a year, we'll come back to the Faith HD, High Definition Faith theme, and we'll focus on some of the major doctrines in our faith so that we're clear about what the Bible teaches and that we're prepared to answer questions and have intelligent conversations with folks. And the series that we're going to begin with is titled God Is. We're going to focus exclusively on who God is for the next several weeks and try to really have a high definition, a highly defined faith, highly pixelated, if you will, or if that's the right way to say it, just really clear vision of who God is. A.W. Tozer once said that no religion has ever risen higher than its definition of God. And so we're going to try to really have a clear definition of who God is. Now, to do that, to begin this morning, I thought it would be interesting if we started with some verbal audience participation. Now, I specify verbal, okay, because you're always participating in the process of communication, whether you're speaking or not. Listening is at least 50% a part of the process of communication, and frankly, I think the hardest part. Well, which it doesn't make any sense because we have public speaking courses, but we don't have listening lessons. And listening is a lot harder than speaking is. Listening well is just a hard thing to do, which is a really good place for me to say thank you because you guys listen really, really well. You were great active listeners. And so it's a privilege to address you every week because you're some of the most discerning, affirming listeners that I've ever had the pleasure of speaking to. You're welcome. You're welcome very much. Thank you. We're not ready for the verbal part yet, okay? And actually, you're not included. So, all right. So here's what I'd like to do. And I'm gonna have my assistant Abby Mullins is going to come up here, and Abby's going to help me with this. And what we're going to do is I'm going to start a sentence, God is, and then I'm going to ask you to finish that sentence, and Abby is going to write these down. I chose Abby because I watched her doodling in church one day, and she's really good. So she's very good with a pen. And I will say that I doodle in every meeting I attend, and people think I'm not listening. No, I'm doodling so that I can listen to you. That's why I'm doing it, all right? That keeps my mind occupied while I listen to the things that you're saying. So So here's what we'll do. We're gonna, if we do it all at once, it'll just be cacophonous. So what we're going to do is we're going to start with this section right here, this right over here, your section A, and I'm going to say God is, and then you'll give me something back. And then we're going to go to the balcony. You guys doing okay up there? Good deal. Good. We'll go to the balcony, and then we'll come over here, okay? So first, B, and toi, okay? There we go. All right. That was French, by the way, okay? So you guys ready? Okay, God is, and what I want you to do is just shout it out, and we'll pick one. God is?
Love.
Love. Boy, that was good. And I think I heard somebody over here. It's not your turn. Okay, right here. God is not a God of chaos. It's order, all right? So God is love. All right, balcony. God is? Well, I didn't hear a word you said. Good. God is good. Good. In a minute, we're probably just going to have to go with the word. But God is dot, 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 and then fill them in. Okay. Wait, God is love. God is good. What do we got over here? God is awesome. Write the word awesome. God is awesome. All right. We got God is good. God is love. God is awesome. God is? Wow. Light. God is light. Is that L-I-G-H-T? Yes. God is not L-I-T-E. God is? Faithful. God is faithful. F-A-I-T-H-F-U-L. Yep. Faith. She's, after church, she's going to kill me, right? God is?
Kind.
I heard God is kind. God is kind. God is? Holy. I heard God is holy right here. God is? Strong. I heard God is strong. We got a holy, strong, and just. You doing okay?
Yeah, I'm just nervous.
Just nervous? Okay. All right. Okay. That's okay. Your back is to them. Okay. Okay, where do we stop? Right here? One more, right? God is?
Grace.
God is grace. Good job. Okay, we could do this all morning long. You know why? Because here's another one. God is infinite. Okay, this could take a very long time. Give Abby a hand. Thank you, Abby, for helping us out here. Let's roll this back over here. Get this out of the way. Kind of push on that. See, I told you, she's got great penmanship, doesn't she? That looks good. If I had done that, we'd all be going, that's confusing. So, all right. So, we may look at some of these, in fact, over the next several weeks. But like I said, we could go on and on doing this all morning long because there's so many things we can say about God. But here's how I'd like for us to begin the series this morning on who God is, all right? I'd like to begin it this way. God is, and this is going to sound weird, a plausible possibility. God is a plausible possibility. So let me kind of unpack that a little bit because it sounds like a weird thing for the preacher to say. Since perhaps as early as 1859, when Charles Darwin published The Origin of the Species, and certainly since 1925, when John Scopes was tried for teaching evolution in Dayton, Tennessee, the dramatic overlay, the thematic overlay of almost all of our public discourse about faith and reason and about science and religion has been that there's this intractable opposition between science and Christianity, that the two just cannot have a good conversation, that they can't get along, that you either have to embrace one or reject the other. And that's the way the conversation's been framed. It's been framed up with these rather untenable choices for us. You could either be pious or you can be intelligent. You can be faithful or you can be rational. John Stackhouse wrote a book called Humble Apologetics, and he put it pretty clearly. He says that science teaches us what we need to know, and he's talking about the way this conversation is framed in our culture. Science teaches us what we need to know. Technology helps us do what needs to be done. Modern people, therefore, simply don't need Christianity. Indeed, religious faith, from the point of view of the culture, is the mark of an unsophisticated and probably impaired mind. There are increasingly large numbers and very vocal people who think that belief in God is an indicator of a lack of ability to think critically. It's an absence of sophistication and the tendency toward the irrational. They think that if you believe in God, if I believe in God, we're just not all there. New York Times bestselling author Sam Harris is one of the evangelists of atheism. About 10 years ago, these guys started really publishing and writing and speaking. Harris thinks that you are an imbecile if you believe in God. That's on page 11 of the introduction of his book, Letter to a Christian Nation. In fact, in that book, he asserts, in Letter to a Christian Nation, he asserts that the Confederate South, where slavery was defended at the point of a gun barrel, was comprised of, quote, the most pious Christians the country has ever known. That's page 19. My great-great-grandfather fought in the Battle of Atlanta on the losing side, and I'm glad his side lost. It is absolutely not accurate. It is patently biased to call the defenders of slavery the epitome of the Christian faith. It would be more accurate to say that Christians were among those who were promoting and fighting for and pushing for freedom, for the abolition of slavery. That's where the abolition movement began. On page 90 of Letter to a Christian Nation, Harris compares religion to rape and claims that the greatest impediment to a public discourse that encourages critical thinking and intellectual honesty is the respect we accord religious faith. The biggest obstacle to a decent conversation is the respect that's shown to religious faith. Now, don't bother trying to find Mr. Harris on Facebook or looking up his email and send him an ugly note. Letter to a Christian Nation was in part a response to the many hate emails he received from Christians after his first book, The End of Faith. Very often, we do more damage to our cause than all the critics put together. If you want to do something, live a loving, consistent Christian life, that will do more than all the arguments in the world. My point is that many people think that belief in God is simply not a plausible possibility, at least not for intelligent people. The message we get from authors like Mr. Harris, from the news media, from television, and the movie industry is that the only people who buy into all this God stuff are people who couldn't reason their way out of a shoebox. I only have one aim this morning. My only aim this morning is to convince you or to reassure you, depending on where you are, that believing in God is, in fact, a rational option for your life. You don't have to check your mind at the door of the church building. Faith is not a synonym for fable. Being religious doesn't make you a buffoon. Dr. Anthony Flew was one of the world's leading philosophers, and for most of his life, an atheist. Flew was raised in a Christian home, but became an atheist at the age of 15. The Times of London called him one of the most renowned atheists in the past half century, whose papers and lectures have formed the bedrock of unbelief for many adherents, end quote. Here's a famous quote from Dr. Flew. If it is to be established that there is a God, then we have to have good grounds for believing that this is indeed so. Unless and until some such grounds are produced, we have literally no reason at all for believing, and in that situation, the only reasonable posture must be that of either the negative atheist or the agnostic. Notice that he calls that the only reasonable posture. You don't need an advanced degree in logic to conclude then that believing in God from that perspective is an unreasonable option. In 2004, something interesting happened. Dr. Flew told his longtime friend and debate opponent, Dr. Gary Habermas, that he had become a theist. Habermas is a Christian and had befriended and worked with Dr. Flew for many years, and this was such a dramatic change that this renowned atheist was now saying that there is something out there. It was such a dramatic change, it even made Jay Leno's monologue on The Tonight Show. Jay Leno said, of course he believes in God now. He's 81 years old. He's close. Now, I don't want you to get the idea that Dr. Flew became Brother Flew, and he moved to Nashville, and he taught Sunday school at Granny White Pike Church of Christ. That didn't happen. Okay, it's not accurate to say that Dr. Flew came to believe in the God of the Bible. Like Albert Einstein, he came to believe that the complexity of the universe provides compelling evidence of an intelligence. He didn't become a Christian. He did not believe that Jesus is the Son of God, although he did say that the evidence for the resurrection of Jesus is better than for claimed miracles in any other religion. The thing I want you to see, though, is that he was no longer an atheist. Something or someone is out there before, beyond the universe. He told his friend Gary Habermas, we must follow the argument wherever it leads. Now, of course, when somebody like that switches to consider the option of God is that's really plausible, that's actually sensible, that's rational, they can't handle that. So the New York Times Magazine ran an article alleging that Dr. Flew's new position emerged because his intellect had declined with age. In other words, he had become unreasonable. I get out of my depth pretty quickly when we start talking about astrophysics or genetics or philosophy, but I can tell you this much. Well-reasoned arguments backed by consistent Christian living and loving, respectful friendship over a long period of time were among the things that opened the door of faith to Dr. Flew. I don't know whether he walked through that door. I don't know how far into that corridor he walked, but the door was opened. And I know that he did not lose his ability to think rationally, to reason critically, or to carefully examine evidence. He was as sophisticated and intellectual as you will find. And he concluded that God is a reasonable conclusion. In 1744, John Wesley confessed, I am convinced, you guys really need to pay attention to this, okay? This will be good for you. I am convinced from many experiments, I could not study either mathematics, arithmetic, or algebra without becoming a deist, if not an atheist. This is why you guys need to study history. Next time your parents get on you about your math homework, quiver in your voice, tear in your eye, look at them and say, Mom, Dad, don't you understand that the founder of Methodism was afraid to study math because it might make him an atheist? Are you trying to wreck my faith? It'll work, except unless they're here. If they're here today, it won't work. But I don't know why John Wesley was afraid of math. I know some pretty sharp math folks who have pretty deep faith. And I know that Charles Edward White says that the numbers these days point to God, not away from God. In fact, based on some of the work of Stephen Hawking, who is an atheist, Oxford mathematician Roger Penrose calculated the chances of a universe suitable for life occurring at random at 1 in 10 to the 10,123rd power. The chances that life could occur in the universe at random, 1 in 10 to the 10,123rd power. That number is so far beyond my comprehension, and in fact, beyond the possibility of even illustrating. If you started writing the zeros, you'd run out of universe before you ran out of numbers. The probability that a life-sustaining universe happened by random chance is so small that it approaches impossibility. Take a look at this. These are the letters from a Scrabble game, A to Z. That's what they have. Now, for those of you born recently, Scrabble is what the game Words with Friends is based on. We used to have to actually pick up these little wooden tiles and place them on a board to spell words, and there wasn't a little thing to check to see if that's really a word. You had to really know it. So if you were to toss those letters into the air, The chances that they would come down in order are 500 million, million, million to one. There's a greater chance of those letters lining up. When you throw them up into the air, there's a greater chance of those letters lining up than that this life-welcoming universe just happened. It is not implausible. It is not unreasonable. It is not irrational to believe that there is a God. Michael Behe is a biochemist at Lehigh University and author of a book called Darwin's Black Box. It's critical of Darwin's theory of evolution. You should know that Behe still believes in the common descent of species. He does, however, argue that some structures in nature are too complex to be explained by evolutionary mechanisms. As an example, he noted the difference between his neighbor's yard and his own. His neighbor's mailbox is surrounded by a stand of beautiful yellow flowers, tulips, obviously arranged in an intentional, purposeful way. His own yard was randomly sprinkled with other flowers, dandelions, obvious sign of owner neglect. He kind of moved from that casual observation to a more cosmic question. He said, what if you find out that not only is the tulip bed designed, but so is the tulip? What if all the world's a stage and there is a real set designer? Hebrews 3:4. For every house is built by someone, but God is the builder of everything. Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. It is not implausible to believe that God is the intelligence behind the design. It is not improbable to believe that God is the designer of the universe. It is not irrational to believe that God is the builder of the house. This occurred to me a couple of weeks ago. In 2015, technology companies spent $8.5 billion and on deals and investments in artificial intelligence, AI. That's four times the amount that was spent in 2010. Google, Microsoft, Facebook, Amazon, and other companies are all buying up smaller startups, and they're hiring AI experts and pouring money into research. They obviously believe in the potential that artificial intelligence has to enhance the world, or at least to enhance their profits, which I do not begrudge them. There are other people like Elon Musk and Bill Gates and Stephen Hawking who have voiced concerns over the emergence of this new frontier. They worry that AI could be more dangerous than nuclear weapons. That's a really interesting debate, but a little beyond what we're talking about this morning. Here's the irony to me. Apparently, very intelligent, very rational, very wealthy people believe that it takes a lot of resources and a lot of brain power to create artificial intelligence. So why is it unreasonable, implausible, unsophisticated to believe that it took resources and brilliance to create organically intelligent beings who are trying to simulate themselves? It is not unreasonable. You are not irrational. You are not a buffoon if you believe Psalm 139, verse 14. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. Next week, we're going to take a look at how God is different. Let's close with a prayer. Let's go ahead and stand right now, shall we? Father, we pray that we will be people who know how to give an answer to those who ask us for the hope that we have. We pray that we'll be clear about what we believe. We pray that we will be honest. We pray that we'll be open to questions and unafraid to deal with them. We thank you that in Scripture, when people doubt, you don't condemn, you give them evidence. You answer their questions. You are not afraid of truth, and so neither should we. God, help us never to be arrogant, but to be humble, to be loving, to live consistent lives, and realize that the job of conviction belongs to you and your Spirit, and our job is to witness, to testify, and to live lives consistent with what we say. God, I pray for those in our church this morning who struggle with this doubt, that they'll be able to ask their questions here and be cared for and loved, welcomed and received, and that we'll walk with each other on this journey into a clearer, more highly defined faith. We love you. We praise you for all that you have made. We acknowledge that you are God beyond our comprehension, but we want to understand you more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing.
Our God, whose Son upon a tree, a life was willing then to give, that he from sin might set them free, and evermore with him could live.
There is a God.
There is a God.
He is alive.
He is alive.
In him we live.
We survive.
And we survive from dust
of
God.
Attention to 39ers trip, a wedding shower today at 1:30 in the Mercy Building for Russell Mann and his fiance. Easter chorus again this week, and please note there will be no classes a week from Wednesday during spring break, along with these other things. We hope you have a great week. Keep believing. Let's close in prayer.
Let us pray. Dear God, you are truly infinite. You're all those things on the board and so much more. Thank you for giving us all the blessings you've bestowed upon us, even as much to send your Son to take the hit for us. Please put it on our hearts to give so that we can receive a blessing, because this is more blessed to give than to receive. Thank you for all these things that Jody taught us today. We pray that we'll have the courage to take these things into the workplace, to school with us, and to be a witness to you. Be with us this week. Help guide us with your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.